कचार्यं संवदाख्यं संभूमनांसि जानतां. May we march forward with a common goal. May we be open-minded and work together in harmony. A very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you all for joining us in today's webinar on Floral Induction and Development, organized by Department of Botany, Surendranath College, under the DBT Star College Strengthening Scheme. I am Dr. Surendranath Sarkar. I am your host for this session. To formally inaugurate the session, I want to introduce our today's honorable speaker, Dr. Tathagata Rai Choudhury. Our today's honorable speaker, Dr. Tathagata Rai Choudhury, is an associate professor, Department of Botany, Ashutosh College, and has near about 22 years of teaching experience. He was the head of the Department of Botany from 2009 to 2019. He was also the HOD of Environmental Science of Ashutosh College from 2017 to 2020. Currently, he is engaged as IQAC coordinator since 2014 and academic staff affairs in charge since 2018. He completed his graduation and post-graduation both from Kulani University and was a silver medalist in BSc and gold medalist in MSc. He qualified CSIRNE and did his PhD from Bose Institute, Kolkata back in 2005. He has 10 academic research papers in reputed national and international journals to his credit. Today's lecture is specially organized for you, my beloved students. I'm sure you will be immensely benefited by this lecture. So without wasting any time, I would request our honorable speaker, Dr. Tathagata Rai Choudhury, to deliver the talk. Over to you, Dr. Rai Choudhury, sir. Thank you.
Well, thank you. It was a very beautiful introduction of me. Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction. I would like to first thank the organizers for inviting me to give such a lecture in such a reputed college, and that too under a DBT Star College scheme. Now, I had the idea that this lecture was for the students of the undergraduate students of botany, but now I find that there are many participants who are actually faculty members, so I am a bit worried, you know. Now, first let me admit that the area which I'll be talking about today was not my research area anytime. I never worked on this area ever. Whatever I am delivering today is from the books and from the research papers, maybe little reference to them, that I have been able to get for the last 20 years of teaching and before that as a student. First, let me know what is the preferable language of delivery? Is it Bengali or English? Bangla or samasya ache? Ma'am, Dipushti ma'am or
sir, mostly shabai Bengali the oshubidhe nei kichu jon ache jader ektu Bengali
the. I'll be very easy, no problem. Okay. And the thing is that I never worked in this area. Now, whatever I'm delivering today is what I read in the books, textbooks, and journals, maybe sometimes for the last 20 years as a teacher, and then maybe as a student also. I had some experience in going to the textbooks. So basically, I'm trying to present to you today the information I have been able to collect in my total tenure of my career of teaching. Secondly, which I want to say is that this area, this floral induction and induction of flowering, has been having a lot of publications the last, say, 20 or 30 years. Now, to accumulate the information of all these together will give a huge amount of literature. Now, I being an undergraduate teacher, I have a little experience in postgraduate, less a little bit of nothing much. So I have kept my lecture restricted at the undergraduate honors level. So this is for the students of botany who are studying their first to sixth semester. It is not meant if somebody is expecting something new. I don't think I will be able to give you that, because for me, giving a base to the students, this lecture is just trying to form a base for the students who are studying the bachelor's degree in honors. During my lecture, if anybody has any questions, please feel free to stop me and ask anything you want to know. So should I start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So please see if you see my screen or not. Screenটা visible আছে?
Yes, sir, visible.
Yes, sir, visible.
Should I start? Now, this is my topic, solar induction and development. Now, for any person who is starting to study botany, the flower is one of the very important plant parts that we study. Now, starting from the very base, what is a flower? Now, that is a very simple question. We say a flower is a reproductive structure found in flowering plants, the function of which is to facilitate reproduction, that is the male gamete or sperm or pollen, what you will call it, will fertilize with the egg. That's what we call a flower to be. The next question is, where is a flower? Where do we find a flower? Now, those who we used to study the books, the college botany chapter chilo, flower is a modified shoot. So the shoot apex means apical part of the shoot, will change to form a flower, will be modified in course of time to form a flower. And the arrangement of it is known as the inflorescence. So basically, flower is a modified shoot, and the arrangement of flower is called the inflorescence. Next we come is, when is a flower formed? When? But because a plant obviously is not born with a flower. Flower is born when the shoot apex is converted to a flower or flower bearing axis. And this takes place only when it reaches a particular age. We call it the cell. The shoot apex is now mature or is competent to become a flower. So that is what we talk about the flower, where it is, what is it, and when it is. Now comes, how does a shoot apex, that is the apex of a shoot or a branch, modify into a flower? So that we can call it the induction of flowering. Now, there are different theories or different concepts or different ideas that led to the discovery of the so-called role of different factors in induction of flowering. These factors include light. When light is having a role in flowering, we call it photoperiodism, the timing of light. There has been experiments to prove that temperature can also have a role in flowering. We call it vernalization. And there are theories that plant hormones also have a role in flowering. We call it role of hormone in flowering. So basically, the induction of flowering comes down to a level of studying of effect of light duration, temperature, and hormone in induction of the flowering in the shoot apex. Now we start with, we have three different stories actually. One is for photoperiodism, one is the story of vernalization, and one is the story of hormone. So we start with the story of flowering with the story of photoperiodism. Now, what is photoperiodism? photoperiodism is a biological response to the length and timing of day length and light. That is the biological response that will be depending on the length of light or length of day, which will bring about a particular response. The flowering response to day length is called photoperiodism. Now, the work of photoperiodism started in the USA United States Department of Agricultural Research Farm in Arlington. It was known as the Arlington Experimental Farm. This is a picture of the early 1930s where the Arlington Experimental Farm was working. Now, this Arlington Experimental Farm, this is another picture of it. You see in the just beside the river over here, we have these particular area. These are the experimental farm. This US Department of Agriculture Experimental Farm, they had laboratories, they had greenhouses, they had a few fields, and it was situated beside the river Potomac. And this was the experimental farm where the first work on photoperiodism started. Now, if you note here, just below the experimental farm, you see a military road. There was a military base somewhere just beside the farm. And you can see the Washington Airport down there. This I mentioned because I'll come back to this later on. So this is the place where in 1920s, the first work on photoperiodism started. These are the four people who worked extensively in that particular Arlington experimental farm on photoperiodism. From left, this is W. Garner, H. A. Allard, James Bonner, and Carl Hamner. All these scientists were working in that Arlington experimental farm of USDA, and they did some very first initial work in the discovery of the so-called photoperiodism and its regulation. The first work or first established published paper, which was a significant paper, was by Garner and Allard. They started on biloxi swabbing. Now look at this chart. In the chart you see that the germination date and the flowering date is written. The third column is the number of days from germination to flowering. And on the last column, we see the plant height. So you find that in case of biloxi soybean, when germination date is 2nd of May, the flowering date is on September 4th. 125 days it takes to flower, and the height of the plant is 52 inches. Whereas in the last column, you see that hello? Hello?
Yes, sir, audible.
When germination date is 16th August, the flowering date is 16th October, 61 days to flowering, and this signature have to change, sorry, it will be 20 inches. I mixed this one, 20 inches. So you see that there is, if we vary the, date by 59 days in germination, 59 days in germination means from May 2nd to August 16th. One is germinating on May 2nd, the last plant germinates on August 16th. The difference of germination date is 59 days, 2 months. But when you see the flowering date is only 11 days to first flowering. So the difference of germination date has no effect on the first flowering. Neither does the plant height. The plant height, not the plant age, is regulating flowering. That led to them to the first question is, what then is controlling the flowering response? Next, Garnell and Allard started working on a tobacco plant which they named Maryland Mammoth, which flowers in winter. What they did was, they wanted to study the different environmental conditions on flowering. The concept is, if a plant is flowering in winter, what is the factor that is regulating the flowering to take place in winter? Because from summer to winter, if you take two extremes, summer the temperature, the soil, the water content, the light exposure is different from the winter. So what they did was, they started working on very tall and leafy mutants of tobacco, which was known as Maryland Mammoth Tobacco. Garner and Allard found that whatever size the pot they put in and how well they are fertilized, whatever treatment they give them, these plants will never flower in summer. Even they reach the height of 10 to 15 feet. So the plant will keep on growing vegetatively till it will flower only in the winter. This is a picture you see. The left-hand side, we see the wild-type tobacco plant grown in greenhouse of winter. The left one. And the right one you see is the same plant grown in summer, and the plant is growing without flowering. So the plant height is varying drastically in the winter and the summer just because of the environmental conditions. So they set up this chart, something like this. It was not this chart, maybe. First column, they give the conditions. Conditions are duration of light, temperature, nutrition, humidity, light intensity, and effect. Now they studied these plants. This is the picture of the Arlington farm where they used to carry out the experiments. They had this, the picture A, the top left-hand side, is the dark house. They used to keep it in the sun for some time, push it back to the dark house, bring it out again. So they control the light in this way. So what they did was, look at this chart. Condition one, light duration of the sun means summer, and the blue logo means winter. Okay. So condition of light of day of summer, temperature of summer, nutrition of summer, humidity of summer, light intensity of winter. No effect. You see, none of these four, first four columns, if we vary the duration, if we vary the light intensity of winter, rest of summer, no response. Second row, humidity of winter, rest of summer, no response. Third, nutrition of winter, rest of summer, no effect. Fourth, temperature of winter, rest of summer, no effect. Only in the fifth line, you see, when you vary the duration of light, give the plant the duration of light exposure like winter, and keep all conditions like summer, flowering will take place. So basically, the experiment proved that the duration of light has an effect on flowering. That is, if we have a plant which flowers during winter, if we give it the light of winter under any circumstances, rest of the conditions being whatever, just the duration of light will regulate flowering. If you give it the duration of light of winter, keeping rest conditions of summer, it will flower. This was the first work by, published work by Garner and Allard, published in Journal of Agricultural Research, 1920, from Washington, D.C. This is an 88-page journal, a paper. If you have, it's available in the, agricultural website. You can get it down from there. So they gave a detailed report, it was like tables after tables after tables of how they kept on working on this particular area to get this particular result. So the question one was, what controls flowering response? The answer to this, as in 1920, was the duration of day length concludes flowering. Now, these group kept on working in this area. Now, that what response they got was based on one or two crops, that is either biloxi swabbing and on that Maryland mammoth tobacco. They kept on working with different plants. And they found that most plants or many plants had a response which plants can respond to the light duration according to certain parameters. What was the parameter? The parameter they called critical day length. Shortly plants will flower when the day length is less than critical day length. A longly plant will flower when the day length is more than a critical day length. For example, if I have a shortly plant with flowers with a critical day length of 10 hours, it will flower in 10 hour light, 9, 8, 7, 6, back till 1. But it will not flower 11, 12 and more. Similarly, if I have a longly plant having a critical day length of 10 hours, it will flower in 10, 11, 12, 13 till 24 maybe, but it will not flower in 9 to 1. This is the basic concept. However, there are plants which are called long short day plants, short long day plants, day neutral plants. I mean, leaving them because I don't think that this has much importance right here. So basically, plants can be characterized as short day plants and long day plants. Now, this is a picture again showing the effect of critical day length on flowering. Actually, 1 second. You see, the first left hand side, we have a Maryland mammoth tobacco plant, which is a short day plant. You see, of these four lines of the left, we have when we see this line 14 hours, the Maryland mammoth will flower when the critical day length is shorter than 14 hours. The first two, there is no flowering. In the lower two, when the critical day length are shorter than 14 hours, flowering takes place. Similarly, in the right-hand side, we have a plant, Hyoscyamus niger, where is a long day plant. It will flower only when the critical day length is more, the exposure is more than a critical day length. So the plant has a critical length of 14 hours. The first two lines, we find that the day length is more than 14 hours, so it is flowering. In the lower two, the day length is less than 14 hours, so it is not flowering. So this is another graph which shows the critical day length, the minimum day length for long day plant and maximum day length for short day plant to flower. Okay, am I clear till now? Has anybody any queries? Because, or should I continue? When I want to have some feedback on this. Anybody, any queries, anything want to deposit? Should I continue or should I wait for your feedback?
Sir, I think you can continue. When if they have any question, they can write it down in the chat box.
Please. Speaking without an audience in front is something
very. We'll have the question answer session at the end.
Okay. If you don't understand the first part, you won't be able to the second part. So first part query, you go first query. I'm going to show you the high. That's my suggestion. I know.
There are some questions in the chat box now. Also, would you like to take it now?
Right. Brother.
Amita, would you proceed? Amita?
Yeah. Am I audible to everybody?
Yeah.
Okay, very good afternoon to everyone. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Dr. Amit Shah. I myself did BSc honors from Ashutosh College and passed out in the year 1999. So it is a really very nostalgic for me to hear your lecture now. So now I will ask the questions which are there in the chat box right now, just now. Just give me some time, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. One question is there. How the critical day length is formed?
A critical day length is formed, if I mentioned before, let's be going back a few slides, that the critical day length is formed, they carried out, look at the start A, left hand side, upper side. What they're doing is they're taking a plant, keeping them in different conditions of light, say 5 hours alata rakhlo, bagita ondo kare. They tested for each plant for each exposure to light. They found out the critical day length. This is the process they used.
Okay. One more question is there, sir. What does critical day actually mean in term of plants? One of the students is asking.
Okay, that question, you will get the answer once the whole thing is over. Because critical, now what happened was, in this case of research in photoperiodism and cardiac, there were certain experiments, there were certain results. So people were happy with the results. And then after some time, the result which was found in the previous experiment was found to be wrong, and a new result came up. So critical day concept of shirakom. Bar change hoyeche. So I think we finish the whole thing and then we get, I will answer this one.
We
came to this critical day length. So then again in 1923, they again published a paper by Garner and Allard. Now if you look at this particular paper headline, among the topic, you see that Garner and Allard both are now designated as physiologists. So they were working on plant physiology experiments, and the results they were getting, they were interpreting it. So the question one, which was what controls flowering response, the answer came: duration of day length will control it, and plants can be classified as short day plants, long day plants, day neutral plants being having no effect on photoperiodism, and there are certain types. So this was the answer which was valid around 1920-23. Now there's two people, these two scientists again working on the same Saint Agricultural Center. They started to question that whether the day length actually controls flowering. This is on the left, we have James Bonner, and the right, you see Carl Hamner. Very, he's having something, Belja-like thing in his hand, which he used to control the exposure to light. But when you cover it with this Belja-like substance, there is no light, so it's dark phase. And then you open it up, it becomes a light phase again. Now what they found, now these are the dark houses over there. There they used to keep the plants light for some time and push it inside. You can use a trolley lagano chilo, taka taka chilo, push it inside for the dark phase. So they varied the duration of light this way, pushing it inside the dark for a few hours, bringing it out again. Now they exposed again the same thing, various day lengths, various night lengths, and they found that the results were something different. Now look at this chart. We have a plant. First response, 16 hours of day length, 8 hours of night or darkness. There is no flowering. So you see the first picture, in the graphical form, 16 hours and 8 hours. 16 hours light, 8 hours dark, no flowering. Second, they took 8 hours a day and 16 hours of night. Flowering is yes. So no problem. The first two is very normal results. Now look at the third one. You have in the second one, you have 8 hours of day length and 16 hours of light, night length. There is flowering, no problem. You just half it. 8 hours become 4 hours of day, 16 hours becomes 8 hours of night. So technically we have a 1:2, light is to dark. First, in the second row, 8:16, third row, 4:8. The ratio is same, but the third row, there's no flowering. come to the fourth row. Day length 16 hours. First row, day length was also 15 hours. First row, 8 hours night, no flowering. In the fourth row, 32 hours night, yes, flowering. So logic is, if 16 hours of a day can stop flowering in one, in row one, why not 16 hours of day length stop flowering in row four? Number one, if 1:2, light is to dark, can bring flowering in row two, why not 1:2, light is to dark, bring flowering in row three? The conclusion they said was that it is irrelevant what the day length is. Irrelevant, doesn't matter. 16 hours, 8 hours, 4 hours, doesn't matter. What matters is the night length. This plant we worked on was Xanthium, needs around 9 hours, 8.5 hours or more night. So in number 2 row, 16 hours, more than 8, flowering. Fourth row, 32 hours, more than 8, flowering. So it is the duration of night that matters and not that of day. Okay. Now, if you ask me, how do you get 32 hours of night? I don't. But that is done in the experimental farm. They keep a plant 32 hours dark, and then they keep it out for 15 hours, both under artificial light conditions. We cannot do this experiment in the normal place because we won't have 62 and 32 together. So with this experiment, they concluded that maybe it is the night length that is mattering. 8.5 hours or more night length, irrespective of the day length, is being about flowering. So flowers at critical day length of 15.5 or less, night length 8.5 or more. So more than 8.5 hours or night, whenever it is, it will flower. Then they move on to another type of experiment, another set of experiments. This is a short day plant. The 24 hour is from, 24 hour scale is in the left. Now, if you see, the dotted line is the critical duration of darkness. If you see the, when the, as it is a short day plant, so in the first column, the light, the exposure to light is more than critical day length, so no flowering. In the second row, we find the day length is less than critical day length, so flowering takes place. The first two is well done, no problem. First one, less than day length, more than critical day length, no flowering. Second one, day length, less than critical day length, so flowering. Now look at the column number, the 2 and 3. Picture, the second and third row shows that the light length is same, the day length is same. The effect should be same. But if you interrupt the light, dark phase with light, the effect which it should have been is reversed. That is, in the second, in the middle part, in the middle row, you see that the plant is having a dark period of more than critical day length and the plant is flowering. The third row also the same time, same duration, except that the dark phase is now interrupted, the flash of light. So the flowering is gone. So they said the continuity of dark period is important. There should have been another row in the picture where they showed that the light phase when interrupted with dark, it has shows no effect. So the dark phase continuity is important. As same picture, first one, long day, critical day length more, day length is more than critical day length, the flowering. Second and third, critical day length, the day length is less than critical day length, so no flowering. And second and third, if you break the night with light, the effect is reversed. So they concluded is, the question one was, what controls flowering response? The answer was duration of day length. Now the answer is wrong. The correct answer is duration and continuity of night length controls flowering. With this, The third question, the second question came now. Which part of the plant will receive the photoperiodic stimulus? So we say the plant is sensing the light duration. We say there's a short day plant, a long day plant. Short day plant, a long day plant means day length, critical day length, less or more. The night phase is important, all is fine. But which part of the plant receives the photoperiodic stimulus? Herein comes the work of Mikhail Kristofovich Shalakhayan. He was working in the Russian Academy of Sciences. He was also working in this area. What they did was they worked on Perilla. Perilla is a short day plant. Now look at the picture. I have three pictures, A, B, and C. In A, the shoot apex is kept in short day. Rest plant is in long day. So this being a short day plant, they have kept the shoot apex in short day. They have made a chamber where a particular part they have cut and put a beaker like covered it with something and give a light over there. So the plant, short day plant, apical part short day, rest is long day. The plant remains vegetative. The second picture, picture number B, they have kept the leaves in short day, rest of the plant in long day. There is flowering. In third picture, they have kept one leaf in short day, rest plant in long day. The plant is flowering. So what is the obvious conclusion is the leaf will sense the photoperiodic stimulus. Leaf is a site of perception. This was the experimental part. Short day condition shoot apex, long day condition rest plant, no flowering. If you keep the leaves in short day, flowering takes place. If you take one leaf in short day, flowering will also take place. So the question two was, which part of the plant receives the photoperiodic stimulus for flowering? The answer was a leaf. So we have now two conclusions. Flowering is regulated by duration and continuity of dark period. Number two, leaf is a site of perception. This leads to the third topic. Now, if you remember when I started talking about flowering, I mentioned the shoot apex is modified to call a flower. Now, if I say that leaf A, the photoperiodic stimulus is being sensed. The leaf is sensing the photoperiodic stimulus, fine. So how does the flowering stimulus, whatever it is, move from leaf to shoot? What is moving? Something must be moving because the leaf is being understanding the stimulus, the shoot apex is expressing it, so something must be joining these two. This experiment was done by Meklers and supported by reports by Shalakhayan also. They kept one leaf in short day and grafted it with different plants. They found that this leaf was exposed to short day and all the plants started to flowering. So they, Shalakhayan and Meklers over here concluded that the flowering stimulus is graft transmissible. That is, the leaf which is exposed to short day is developing the stimulus. The stimulus is moving through the different grafts and all the plants are being stimulated to form flowers. So again, the conclusion hours are increasing. Number one, flowering is regulated by duration and continuity of dark period. Number two, leaf is a site of perception of photoperiodic stimulus. Number three, the flowering stimulus is graft transmission. Now one more, next question came. What is the nature of this flowering stimulus? Flowering stimulus, the key, what is it? Is it a plant, is it a hormone? Is it a chemical? What is it? So that led to, again, Shalakhayan to propose that there is a flowering hormone known as florigen. He proposed that there is a flowering hormone, florigen. It is produced in the leaves. So when the leaf is perceiving the photoperiodic stimulus, it is producing florigen. Florigen is moving from the leaf to the shoot apex and bringing our flowering over there. Now, note the year, 1936. In that year, Chaila Khan proposed that fluorogen is a hypothetical thoral hormone. So the leaf will understand light response short day, long day, jawa jara bujbe. Leaf will make fluorogen. Fluorogen will go to the stem, shoot apex. Shoot apex will convert to flowering. Very good, done. But what is fluorogen? To experimentally prove that fluorogen does exist, they kept a long day plant under long day, grafted it to short day plant under long day. So we have two plants, both under long day, one short day plant, one long day plant, both grafted together. Now both of them will flower. What is the logic? Long day plant under long day will make fluorogen because it's in a long day condition. Because it is grafted, the fluorogen will move from the long day plant to the short day plant to the graft, and both will flower. So very easy. So F is fluorogen being made and TR is fluorogen being transferred. Similarly, short day plant under short day will make fluorogen. If grafted with long day plant under short day, fluorogen will be transferred from short day plant to long day plant for fluorogen both. So fluorogen does exist. That was proved. This was a picture, this is a letter, this is not a picture by Chaila Khan, not a picture. Leaf is toiri hoche, shooting a flowering course. Now, what is fluorogen now? The next question was how and what is fluorogen? Chaila Khan, one of the students of Chaila Khan, started working on gibberellic acid on flowering. If you remember, the three different concepts were there, flowering. One was photoperiodism, one was cold treatment, another was gibberellin. What Lang did, this person was some Lang, long day plant under short day condition, no flowering, fine. This is natural. Long day plant under short day condition plus apply dilute gibberellic acid. Flowering takes place. So, what was the scientist excited about? Now look, long day plant under short day condition, no fluorogen. I give it gibberellic acid, flowering hoche. Tarma gibberellic acid fluorogen. Is gibberellic acid fluorogen? They started to wonder on that. But the problem was the other way around. When short day plant came under long day, previously it was long day kept in short day. Now it is short day kept under long day and give it gibberellic acid as much you want, it would flower. So the confusion of fluorogen remained. Gibberellic acid was not fluorogen, at least not in all cases. The question remained unanswered. This was in late 1940s. So what was the conclusion till 1940? Number one, flowering is regulated by duration and continuity of dark period. Number two, leaf is the site of perception of the photoperiodic stimulus. Number three, the floral stimulus is graft transmissible. We call it fluorogen, but we don't know what it is till now. And gibberellic acid has a role in flowering, but not in all cases. In this time, or parallel to this, it was working parallelly, the concept of vernalization came. Now, what is vernalization? Now, I'm not working on vernalization details, so I'll just tell you the basics. Low temperature treatment to shortening the vegetative phase. So we have a seed, we keep it at a low temperature, it will flower earlier than seed, which is not kept at a low temperature. So there are different theories, not getting into that. So conclusions increase, flowering is regulated by duration continuity, leaf is site of perception, floral stimulus, graft transmissible, maybe fluorogen, gibberellic acid has a role, cold treatment has a role. But unanswered questions key. Flowering is regulated by duration and continuity of dark period, fine. But what is sensing that? What senses duration continuity? Leaf is a site of perception, fine. What in the leaf? What part of the leaf? What chemical in the leaf? No idea. The graft transmissible fluorogen is there. Fine. What is fluorogen? How is it transmitted? how does foliation change the shoot apex to flower? And vernalization, how does cold treatment enhance flowering? So we have five conclusions and five unanswered questions from that. So I will be not talking about the vernalization part from now. What in the leaves receives the stimulus? What is foliation? How is it transmitted? And what it does to make the shoot apex a flower? Am I audible still now? I have a net problem.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Now, what happened was World War II happened. Now, if you just remember, if we have must be remembering, the World War II, the first few years, USA did not participate. So it was the European countries were fighting with, and the USA was not fighting actually, but they were preparing themselves for the war. Now, what they did was Roosevelt. They shifted the agriculture experimental farm to Arlington because if you remember the map part, Arlington pechone chilo hocche Washington airport and ekta army base. The Arlington farm was a temporary housing complex for service members during World War II. The experimental farm was shifted from departmental agricultural farm Arlington theke chole gelo Batesville, Maryland. So this distance was around 2,000 kilometers and that hampered the working for some time. This is the first picture of the Arlington initiative of female civil servant Tesha Namche. Second picture of the Arlington farm at Chobi and left in the down you see the Pentagon. The Arlington farm, the places of the Arlington farm or Arlington farm at different areas in group for Ahochilo to form the so-called present day Pentagon. So Pentagon, যেখানে এখন আছে, Gardner, Allard, Hamner, all এখন সেই জায়গায় কাজ করতে কোন একসাথে. Very interesting fact, yes. Okay, now during the war, or when the war was still going on, the scientists now knew that there is something in the leaf that is persisting the stimulus, photoperiodic stimulus. The stimulus is graft transmissible. They started to look for the next stage of photoperiodism is what in the leaf is actually perceiving the stimulus. The responsibility was given to Harry A. Brodwick. Now Brodwick, the problem was that Brodwick had to approach a colleague, Hendricks, who was a biochemist by nature, who was working X-ray. So they devised different experiments to experiment the reaction of plants to different wavelengths of light. Till now, what they did was short day plant, long day plant, day neutral plant, dark phase, light phase, continuity. They were talking with light as a whole. Now they started to work on what wavelength of light is affecting the flowering. The difference was previously it was light. Light ache, light nahi, duration, continuity, light. It was light as a total. But now they started to work on which wavelengths of light is affecting the responses. This is a picture of Brodwick with Allard in the Maryland Natural Reservoir Pore. Now they developed a different machines. Now what happened after this World War II was different scientists from Europe. They moved on to the USA because America was not in war for first few years of not in war. So till now or till World War II, botany or biological plant sciences were controlled by, was regulated by experimental research. That is, you do some experiments, see the results, and interpret the results. Something like a Mendelian concept, where you crawl into dwarf, you cross, see the data, interpret it your way, and get your results. Just during this war, many people who were basically physicists or chemistry students, they started to get into this biological sciences business. What happened was, number one, there were development of better instruments for better dissection and analysis of the plant responses. First spectrograph was determined. Spectrographic equal using prism, they exposed different wavelengths of light to the plants. At the time of the what they were doing, exposing them to light directly. Now they used different wavelengths of light to see which wavelength of light was being about the effect. Previously it was light as the acrocom, not a crocom. Acrocom light and cold wavelength of acrocom, now no acrocom, that they studied. They found the red light had a strong inhibitor of flowering. This scientist, Robert Dawes, he reported that the varying the red light and far red light, that is exposing a plant to red light, far red light, again red light, again far red light, the responses can be switched on and switched off like a switch. This is the Botwick studying the effect of red light, light phele phele ora dekhto, effect on the flowering. Look at this picture. You have a graph in the left, be careful about that. The graph is 0 to 24, niche 0 upper 24. Whatever response you see, so when you give a red light, third row, second row the effect hoye chilo, that is reversed. So second row te, the short day plant was flowering, third row te, short day plant not flowering. Why? Red exposure. Red followed by far red, the red effect is reversed. Again red followed by far red followed by red, effect becomes normal. So the effect of red light is being nullified by the far red light. So red, far red, change. Red, far red, normal. Again, this change was taking place by red and far red exposure. Look at the flowering response. Dark, flowering, hello. Flowering, 6. If we interrupt the dark phase with red light, flowering becomes 0. Red, followed by far red, 5.6. Red, far red, again 0. So you see, if the response is ending with red, flowering response becomes 0. Followed, if the red is followed by far red, the flowering response becomes normal again. Though they said there must be something in the plant which is sensing this red and far red light difference. Vinita Devi Prasad, raised hand maybe. Anything? Do you want to say
sir, you continue. If you want to say something, you can write in the chat box.
So now they started to work on the receptor, the photoreceptor on the receptor. They thought that leaf must be having, they started working on that. They went, now look at this, look at the qualification of these people. One is Warren Butler, PhD in biophysics. Carl Norris, BSc in agriculture engineering. Harold Seidelman, PhD in plant biochemistry. So these people were working with, they were instrumentation experts. And Butler and Norris developed, I think it was one of the very first few spectrophotometer. They could detect the light absorption by different pigments. And numerous plants they studied to find out whether this experimental result, that is red, far red, two absorbing forms are existing, that would be find out the expected absorption, red light, far red light, any reversion, they wanted to study for the expected absorption in red light and far red light. This is the Norris with the spectrophotometer with the device. In 1959, they found in certain turnip seedlings the spectral reversibility. That is, the red light form and far red light form were alternating, and that could be isolated. They found that this particular something, which was having a PR red light and far red absorbing form, reversing from one form to another, could be studied, could be isolated, and they could predict that it to be a protein. This was the results that they got. In 1959, they published first paper, detection assay and preliminary purification of the pigment controlling photoresponsive development of plants. Butler, Norris, Seidelman, Hendricks. Now, one thing which must be emphasized right now is phytochrome was discovered in 1959. The structure of phytochrome, as you see it in now in textbooks, came much later, sometimes something in maybe in early 2000s maybe. The structure, there's a difference between purification, isolation, and structure determination. Proteins, though I know there are many people who work with proteins more than I do, but the concept is that proteins can be studied, protein can be characterized, but to determine a structure, you got to crystallize the protein. Unless and until you crystallize the protein, the structure can't be determined. So it can take days or years from isolation of a protein, characterization of a protein, to purification and then to crystallization for study. So the phytochrome structure as we see it today came much later on. Now, it was proposed that, again, this was the best proposal, that phytochrome has two parts. One is a pigment part called chromophore. One is the polypeptide chain called apoprotein. The chromophore part remains attached to the apoprotein through a linkage. Now, what about the two forms? If you remember this experiment, red far-rate form, they say now that phytochrome exists in two forms, the PR form, red light form, and the PFR form, the far red light form. The PR to PFR, PR will absorb red light, convert it to PFR. PFR will absorb far red light, convert back to PR. And PFR will slowly convert back to, PFR will slowly convert back to PR in dark. These two forms are interconvertible. How is interconvertible? When there is a red light falls on PR, there is a rotation of a hydrogen bond between 15 and 16 or 14 and 15, I forgot, which makes the phytochrome have a different type of structure, resulting in the response being PR to PFR. Now, for short day plants, the night length is more. So,
sir, mute hoye geche.
Mute hoye geche?
Haan, mute hoye geche.
No, it's audible.
In short day plant, the night length being long, the PFR is converted more to PR. Obviously, night being long, the PFR is converted to PR more. So low PFR is needed for flowering, and high PR is needed for flowering. For long day plants, it's other way around. For long day plants, it's high PFR and low PR needed for flowering. So now, where were the questions? Okay.
It's not, huh? Yeah, it's audible now, okay.
Now I think I have some problem with the network, I think.
Yeah. Okay, so you can continue.
If you have any problem, please message me, because I won't be able to understand whether I'm cut off.
Yeah, of course, sir.
So what senses the duration and continuity of the light? The answer was phytochrome. That is done. The previous question we had, it is phytochrome. What in the leaf receives and responses to stimulus? The answer is phytochrome, maybe, because that will change from some time. But the next question was, what is the flowering stimulus? Not answered. How does the flowering stimulus change the shoot apex to flower? Not answered. So these are the two questions are done. The phytochrome will sense the flowering, the photoperiodic stimulus, but what it will do later on is not known. Okay. Now, what happened after World War II again was that, as I said, that many people who were from Europe, scientists, they migrated to UK, USA. And there were a birth of molecular biology in different laboratories where biophysics, biochemistry, this area flourished. And people started to working on the different aspect of so-called molecular biology. If you see from 41 to 61, these 20 years, the whole of the life sciences that we knew as of molecular biology, say DNA structure, replication, transcription, regulation, everything was iterative because of input of biophysicists and biochemists in the area of biological sciences. One of the area which people started to work in was to study of mutants. The mutation and its response was one thing that was again very much used for biological sciences after or during the war. People, scientists working on the ideal plant, a model organism of plants was Arabidopsis thaliana. They found that different organs in the plant was determined by expression of certain genes. We call them organ identity genes or genes for floral organ identity. Now these genes would be discovered only after the concept of mutation, development of mutants and study of mutants were possible. Because unless you look at a plant from outside, effect of mutation can only be studied when you know that mutation is affecting the plants, the protein level, molecular level, you can study it, observe it, then only we can get to know the effect of mutation on the plants. Now, if I tell that plants for organ development, there are certain genes. So these genes to switch on for the flowering or to bring about flowering, there has to be switching on of these genes. Flowering is brought about by switching on genes that regulate the formation. Where is the location? Location is the shoot apex. Where is the time when the shoot apex is competent or mature? So induction of flowering will take place only when the flowering genes will be switched on. When it will be switched on? When it reaches maturity at the shoot apex. This is the new organism Arabidopsis thaliana people worked on. They found mutants. You see that the white type will have sepal, petal, stamen, and carpel. We have mutants, Apetalata, Pistillata, Agamas, which all of these, you see pictures, doesn't have all the floral organs. Carosepalache, Carpetalache, Carostamen, Carpel, Gutuyache, whatever. This is the group which worked on in Caltech to study the homeotic genes. This group was led by Eliot Merowitz, and one of the famous people who worked there was Marty Yonofsky, the porobotical on it, Elobra Kachmanachi. In 91, the floral organ identity gene was identified. If I sum up the whole thing, the thing remains, the flower hote gele, these floral organ identity genes has to be expressed. What are the genes? The model ki bolche? There are four holes, sepal, petal, stamen, carpel. The A group of genes is essential for sepal development, A plus B for petal development, B for C, D plus C for stamen development, and C alone for carpel development. So floral organs bolche, sepal et jonno A lagbe, for petals development we need A and B, for stamen we need B and C, and for carpel C, B, C. This model has been changed recently to ABCE model. Eta bolche for sepals we need A plus E, petals A, B, E, stamens B, C, E, and carpel C and E. So this is the latest model of flower gene. So what were the questions and what are the answers? What senses the duration and continuity? It is phytochrome. What in the leaves receives the stimulus? Phytochrome. How does the foliage change the shoot apex to flower? The answer is now with us by switching on the floral identity genes, that is ABC or ABC model. But what remains between is phytochrome is in the leaf. In the shoot apex, we have the ABC genes. How, which is the connecting link between the phytochrome and the ABC is fullerene. But where is fullerene? Fullerene is not there still now. More work started on phytochrome. It was found that phytochrome consists of, okay, let me put it this way. Phytochrome is there. Phytochrome is switching on in some way the floral genes. But how does phytochrome switch on the genes? It was proposed that phytochrome is in the PR form. It is converted to PFR form in red light. PFR form, the upper picture you see is the PR form. The lower picture is the PFR form. When the PR moves to PFR form, the phytochrome opens up, as you see. This exposes certain domains of the protein in the PFR form, which is written as NLS, nucleotide location signal. Nuclear localization signal, sorry. This nuclear localization signal is bound by different proteins which will take the phytochrome to the nucleus, inside the nucleus. So PR to PFR, PFR will expose the nuclear localization signals. The nuclear localization signals will be bound by proteins and the PFR will enter the nucleus. In the nucleus, it will switch on the light regulating genes and will switch off the dark regulating genes. So basically it is a process where the light regulating genes are switched on and the dark regulating genes are switched off. There is a complicated mechanism. I'm not going to get details of it. Just, you see the COP1 is a light response inhibitor. COP1 is stopped, so light response can take place. And the dark regulator is broken, so the dark regulator stops. So what phytochrome does is switching out of light regulated genes. Now phytochrome in two types, one is a light labile form. So again, where we were, duration continuity of light phytochrome, phytochrome receives the signal, fullerene we still don't know, and ABC model is switched on. Now the conclusion that we come now is phytochrome senses light in the leaf. Phytochrome switches on and off genes. The stimulus moves from leaf to shoot to bring about flowering. That means phytochrome must be making something which is moving to the leaf, moving from the leaf to the shoot apex. So phytochrome must have a role in fullerene synthesis. Let me come again. Phytochrome will understand light. Phytochrome will switch on genes. That is done. This gene product will now move to the leaf, move to the shoot apex because it is bringing about flowering. So phytochrome must have a role in synthesis of slow-pole fullerene. In late 1980s, if I'm not wrong, there were discovery of some clock genes. Clock genes are genes which regulate the circadian rhythm. The day-night response of certain plants, animals, including us, is known as clock genes. Now, one of the clock genes that was found to have a role in this particular process is known as the constants gene or CO gene. What is a CO gene? CO gene is a transcription factor. Transcription factors are those which switch on certain, which binds to the promoter and switches on protein genes, certain proteins are being made. So basically what it is that there are certain clock genes. One of the clock genes that is regulated, that is being switched on or has a role in this particular process is the constant gene. Again, what sends the duration of life? Phytochrome, fullerene is not known. In this time, there were two scientists working in the Umeå Plant Science Center, Sweden, Tau Huang and Ove Nielsen. Ove Nielsen was a was a famous person who works in this area. They found that in Arabidopsis thaliana, the model organism of plants, there is a FT mRNA, which is made in the leaf and moves to the shoot apex. And this they propose to be our foreign of interest. What happens? Phytochrome will switch on constants. Constants, the transcription factor that will make FT, which will switch on FT. FT mRNA will be made, the DNA will make mRNA normal. But the protein synthesis won't be there. The protein synthesis, the FT mRNA will move from the leaf to the shoot apex, as Thorigen was supposed to do. Look at picture, photoperiodic stimulus makes CO. CO will make the FT mRNA. The FT mRNA will move to the shoot apex. Now, what will happen in the shoot apex? If you remember, I said there was Thorigen. I said there were phytochrome. Phytochrome is making Thorigen. Thorigen will switch on the flowering genes, but how? Thorigen is now FT mRNA. So light will sense the day length, fine. Short day, long day, whatever. In the leaf, the phytochrome will switch on CO or constants. Done. Constants will switch on FT mRNA, which is our Thorigen. Thorigen will move to the shoot apex. In the shoot apex, the FT mRNA, mane amader so-called Thorigen, will bind with FD to form a FT-FD complex. This FT-FD complex will switch on the homeotic genes like SOC1, AP1, and others, bringing about flowering. Look at this. Left photoperiodic stimulus, CO, makes FT. FT mRNA will go to the shoot apex, form a FT-FD complex. They will switch on the flowering genes to bring about flowering. So, answers done. What senses duration, continuity, phytochrome? What in the leaves receive the signal, phytochrome? What is Thorigen? How is it transmitted? FT mRNA is Thorigen. What it does, it switches on flower identity genes. All our questions is answered. But one answer remains. Then what is the use of short day plant and long day plant? Because in short day plant and in long day plant, both have phytochrome. Both leaves have phytochrome. So in both leaves, there will be PR to PFR conversion. In both leaves, there will be CO. CO will make FT mRNA in both cases. FT mRNA will go to shoot apex in both cases. Their flowering will take place in both cases. So why does the variation take place in short day plant and long day plant? Both should have been same. There should be no response of difference in response to light. After 2 years, a coincidence model was proposed. Now, again, I'm telling you the coincidence model as it is proposed is not so simple as I'm telling you. I'm just giving the basic information because there are, I think, around 50 odd genes now discovered which is controlling this coincidence model. Now, what is this saying? Look at this picture carefully. Now, this is our long day plant. In the long day, it is said that the CO mRNA will be stabilized and form CO protein only and only if CO mRNA reaches its peak during day. So in the top upper picture, short day, CO mRNA reaches its peak at night. So CO protein is not made. CO protein not made, the transcription factor is not there. So FT mRNA not made. In the lower picture, same picture, it looks same, but difference is there. Look at the day length. CO mRNA goes up. CO mRNA goes up. The peak is reached during day. CO protein reaches its peak. So as CO mRNA is now in day, CO protein is stabilized. In the top, in the above picture, CO mRNA peak at night, CO protein not stabilized. In the lower picture, CO mRNA peak in the day, so CO protein is stabilized. So now we will have a production of FT mRNA resulting in Phlogen being formed, resulting in shoot apex being converted to flowering apex. In the rice, the process is much more complicated with a short day plant. This is a general picture which shows that HD1 mRNA, HD1 mRNA is equivalent to CO. HD3A is equivalent to FT. So in short day condition, when HD1 protein is low, HD3A will be go up. So HD1 mRNA is not stabilized because of short day condition. So HD3 mRNA peaks and flowering takes place. Whereas in long day condition, HD1 protein is stabilized. So HD3 mRNA is not stabilized. It inhibits the flowering of HD3 mRNA in short day plants. So I think now the questions are answered. What senses the duration and continuity? Phytochrome. How does the leaf response? Phytochrome. Phlogen, FT-mRNA. Phlogen switch on floral identity genes. And short day plants and long day plants are balanced by coincidence model. Now this is another picture that this whole thing is now, the whole concept changes or is being modified or being added on. Then we talk about CO only, but then there is CDF1. CDF1 is replaced by FKF1. FKF1 accumulates in delay. So this whole regulation has now very complicated. So the basic information is CO has a regulation on FT-mRNA. CO is now proposed to be regulated by many, many more genes. We forgot these two people. One is volatilization, one is gibberellic acid. They are also having some role in flowering. It's very simple. It is said that the flowering gene is SOC1. The left hand, exon left is SOC1. SOC1 was inhibited by a protein known as FLC3. So SOC1 inhibits vegetative to flowering. So resulting in flowering being late. But if we give a cold treatment to these plants, the FLC will be blocked. So if FLC was blocking flowering, and now FLC is blocked, so ultimately flowering is taking place early. The concept is during vernalization, the repressor of the flowering gene is itself repressed. So as the repressor is repressed, the flowering takes place early. How does this repression take place? It has been proposed that it takes place by histone acetylation and histone methylation, and it has been reported to be one of the few epigenetic regulation of gene expression in plants. So now this the whole picture is there. You see photoperiodism pathway, circadian clock makes CO, switches on FT, FT switches on SOC, brings about flowering. The second pathway, vernalization blocks the FLC, which was supposedly blocking SOC. So once SOC is not blocked, SOC can express. So vernalization brings about flowering by activating or by deactivating the repressor. Gibberellic acid and other pathway will also activate SOC. So this is the total picture of flowering as of now. As of now, there are many more genes, but the basic concept is in the shoot apex, the leaf will get the stimulus, short day, long day stimulus. The leaf will make phlogen. How? Leaf will make phlogen by make the short day or long day condition will make CO, a transcription factor. CO will be stabilized in long day condition. So in long day conditions, it will make FT-mRNA. FT-mRNA will go to the shoot apex to form FT-MD complex. It will switch on the SOC genes and other flowering genes of flowering. In vernalization, the cold treatment will block the repressor of the flowering gene. As the repressor will be stopped, will be repressed, flowering gene will express. Gibberellin on its own pathway will regulate the flowering gene, and other autonomous pathway or whatever pathway can also regulate flowering. So this is the latest picture of flowering genes. I have talked about very few of them, and the gene number will go on increasing. By next 5 or 6 or 10 years, maybe there will be a 50 or 60 genes which are regulating the flowering process. But basically, what I wanted to tell today was just the basic information which is needed for undergraduate students who are studying botany as their undergraduate course, as the role of induction or switching of the flower. Thank you. I'm done.
Thank you, sir. Okay, a very good afternoon to everyone once again. I am Dr. Amit Shah, the host for this question answer session. First of all, I would like to thank you, sir, for giving us such an enriching lecture on flora induction and treatment. It's really a great privilege for us and our students to have you as our honorable speaker today. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Am I audible? Yes, Deposhri, am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you are audible. Yes. Okay. Yes.
So, before going on to the question answer session, there is an important announcement regarding feedback for the participants. The feedback link will be provided in the chat box just after the end of the question answer session. Filling the feedback form is mandatory for getting the participation certificate. So students should fill up the all the particulars in the feedback form very carefully. Sir, now with your kind permission, I'd like to start the question answer session. Should I start, sir?
Yes, sure.
Yeah, okay. I think your speech has aroused the inquisitiveness of the students. At the time of registration, we had also got several questions. Since some of the questions are similar, so I am clubbing them for your convenience. Some questions are really thought-provoking, sir. So I will start with the questions in the chat box first. First question is from one of the students is, does the critical day length vary from plant to plant?
Yes, it does, obviously. Every plant has its unique critical day length. May not be unique, but the critical day length will vary from plant to plant depending on the mechanism it works with. So, very correct, actually. Basically, very correct.
Okay. Another question is from a student from Scottish Church College. She is asking, does the whole plant have to be exposed to sunlight to induce flowering? Another question is along with that, or can flowering be induced only by exposing a part of the plant to the appropriate amount of sunlight?
As I said, in the experiments have shown that the exposure of a single leaf to a photoperiod is sufficient to bring about flowering.
Okay. Another question is there, what would happen if a long day plant is interrupted with dark in the light phase? I think you have already told this. Sir, is it audible? What yes. would happen if a long day plant is interrupted with dark in the light phase?
Yeah, it's interrupted in any experimental proof has shown that if you interrupt the dark phase with light, the effect will be reversed. If it was flowering, it will stop flowering. If it was not flowering, it will start flowering.
Okay. Another question is, how did Garner and Allard get the plant to flower in their experiment by just controlling the duration of light and not the temperature?
No, they just kept it because as far as I have read in their paper, they just varied the light duration by exposure to different wavelength, to the conditions, surrounding condition under dark house or under a light affected condition, because there is no mention of varying the temperature. Because now the person who is asking the question, it must be, you must understand that any experiments are done in a greenhouse control condition. So where we can vary anything if you want, we can keep the temperature of summer and the light of winter. It is not being done in the outside, in the nature. So that concept should be there, that the experiments, all these experiments are done in the greenhouse. So where we can vary any condition if you want. Obviously, the person yes. who is asking the question thought that I am in summer and I am taking the cold because it is the level of the house, not in the.
Okay, so I hope the students are definitely understanding the answers as you are explaining all the points very really lucidly.
We had when we were students. So this is what happens. It is the same.
Okay, sir. Another question is fluorigen only a concept? What is it actually?
So I think it is done. Fluorigen is
already. Are there another questions there? Are there any flowering inhibitors? What is their nature? Are there some specific environmental conditions which inhibit flowering?
There are some antifluorigens which are being discovered. I have to check it out once because I'm not very aware of the fact that exactly is there any chemical inside the plant. But there are some reports of antifluorigen in the last 2 or 3 years where they have reported that the fluorigen action has been reversed by applying or some chemicals or by some proteins which are working inside the plants. It's all the work is still going on this, as far as I know.
Okay. And another question is there. What is the effect of vernalization on FLC expression and flowering? That is a flowering locus C. FLC expression and flowering.
Yeah, as I told that vernalization results in the repression of flowering by FLC is reversed by vernalization. What vernalization does actually is it heterochromatizes the particular part of the genome where FLC is located. So what happens is that will in the inhibition part is reversed by this effect.
Another question just posted by one of our students in the chat box. What happens to the short day plant when the day is long?
Short day plant won't flower.
Yes. And is it possible to stop flowering midway?
Stop flowering midway means no. And there is one concept which I skipped purposely because it will be complicating. Now, suppose you have a short day plant which flowers under say 10 hour of light. So one day exposure to that particular wavelength or a particular duration of light is one photoinductive cycle. So some plants are switched, the genes will be switched on by one cycle only. So actively, likely flower kore jabe. And some plants, the photoinductive cycle has to be 4 or 5 or 6 days, but that is accumulative. That is, you can have day one, then day three, day five. So these photoinductive cycles has a role in flowering. Some plants will flower only in one photoinductive cycle. Some plants will flower in more than one photoinductive cycle on 7 or 8 or 10 days. Okay. So if you give it one photoinductive cycle of a plant which needs 5 days, it will flower. After 5 days, I suppose, then only it will flower. I think I'm clear.
Yeah. Another question is there. It was given in the registration form. What is the cadastral interaction? What is cadastral interaction?
Cadastral interaction, I vaguely remember, there are certain the genes of flowering has categorized into 2 or 3 types. One is the meristem identity genes, one of the flowering inducer genes, and one are cadastral genes. They interact with each other to bring about flowering. As far as I remember, I could check it out once. I'm not very sure.
Okay. Another question is there. What is the use of induction in flora?
Induction in
flora.
Induction in flora must look.
Maybe the students trying to add what is the use of floral induction?
Yeah, floral induction is a you can by knowing the photoperiodic time and photoperiodic cycles, we can bring about flowering in any season.
Yeah.
Now that we get flowers, now according to flower we get commercially. Now, these flowers are not supposed to be available all around the year. There are many companies in the Bangalore, many centers, they are working on this particular effect and they are commercially exposing this particular part.
Okay. Another question posted in the chat box just now, it is, does light pollution in cities have any effect on flowering of plants?
I personally did not have any go through any report. Maybe it has.
Okay. Next question is, what would be the nature of the flowering period of a hybrid plant of short day plant and a long day plant? Would the hybrid be called a short day plant or a long day plant?
That depends on the leaf. If the leaf, again, if I have a hybrid plant of a short day and a long day, suppose, if the leaves are exposed to short day plant, if it's a short day, it will flower a short day plant. If you have the leaf of long day plant, it will long day for a long day plant. It is the generation of stimulus that matters. The stimulus effect is same. The foliation of long day and foliation of short day will be same. The effect is what part of the plant which you're exposing light to, is it a short day or a long day? That is more important.
Yes. Okay, sir. I have almost covered all the questions after eliminating the similar questions and other questions we have almost covered in your lecture. So thank you, sir, for answering all the questions of the students with patience. I believe all the queries of the audience has been resolved. We are really grateful to you, sir, for giving us your valuable time and enlightening our beloved students as well as students of different colleges just before their semester exams. I am also very thankful to you for accepting our invitation at short notice for the benefit of the students. Your talk will definitely help the young budding botanists in their future also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now I'd like to request Dr. Dipushri Raya Chaudhary, Assistant Professor in Botany and also the DBT STAR Coordinator of Botany Department at Surendranath College and the DBT STAR College Scheme Government of India, to deliver the vote of thanks and conclude the webinar. Thank you once again, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Over to you, Dipushri.
Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Before concluding the session, I would like to ask the host whether principal sir is there or not, because I saw in between that he came.
Meantime, we have seen, but I don't know whether he's there or not. Right.
Joanto, principal sir is there or not, please. Can you check? So I think I should proceed, right? So thank you.
Yeah, of course.
A very good afternoon, everybody. Normally, our webinars and all these programs, they are concluded with a very articulate vote of thanks from our IQAC coordinator and DBT program coordinator, Dr. Suchandra Chatterjee. But today, due to some emergency meeting, she had asked me to do the job as the departmental coordinator. And I take this opportunity, rather I grab this opportunity to heartily thank our today's speaker, our beloved TRC sir, for being available at such a short notice and enriching our students with his lucid yet in-depth lecture. Can't thank you enough, sir. It was like sitting in your classroom after such a long time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful experience, sir.
Thank you.
Next, obviously, I would like to acknowledge the unconditional support we get from our principal, sir, Dr. Indranil Kaur, who is always encouraging us for organizing more lectures and webinars for the students and teachers alike, followed by our DBT program coordinator, Dr. Suchandra Chatterjee, for guiding us, inspiring us for all these programs. I would like to thank Department of Biotechnology, Government of India, for funding the DBT Star College Trending Scheme, under whose banner this program was organized and under whose funding this lecture was organized. Next, I would like to thank our whole departmental team, because of whom this whole event was made possible. Thank you, everyone. And finally, I would like to thank all our students, our participants, for whom this lecture was organized, for making this event a success. Thank you all. We hope to organize many more events in future for you and make it successful with your support. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think we can end the meeting now.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.